Companies, organizations, and business ecosystems. We have different actions that we initiate, research on those two subjects that are the impact of AI for value creation, but also the impact of AI for work. But also, apart from the research, the pedagogy for you in this room or for you in YouTube. How can we bring you new certificates, new modules, in your training journey within Amiens Business School? But how can we also educate people who are not students, people who are coming from different backgrounds, more broadly speaking, the general public? And that's one of the key role of the Institute, is to reach out to this diversified audience and to demystify the technologies on AI, try to give you the tools, the objective tools, to understand in an accessible way what is AI. And that's why we started with Jean Savignan here, this cycle of conference of mini seminars on the techs, the technologies of artificial intelligence. So we had a first introductory talk last December with Jean-Gabriel Ganassia. We will be talking until the end of June about machine learning, vision, language, robotics, and so on. So today, the goal is to address the question of what is machine learning? What is deep learning? What is it supposed to do? And for this, we are very happy to have an expert coming from a well-known institution in Lyon. But really here, the subject will be to give you the tools to understand in a hopefully accessible way what we are talking about. What are neural networks, how it works, how can they replicate cognitive skills so that a machine can act according to a human being. So I will now hand up the mic to Jean, who will with pleasure introduce Céline Robardet.
Thank you, Renaud. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Professor Céline Robardet. She's professor of computer science at INSA Lyon and works as a researcher in the LIRIS lab of University of Lyon 1, which is the largest computer science lab in Lyon, in the Lyon area. Céline works, she's a leading expert in machine learning, and she specializes in learning from data structured as graphs, such as networks, for example. She has published over 70 research papers in the best journals and conferences in machine learning. She has headed also research projects and research grants from the French government, the ANR, for example, and recently she's the coordinator for the Lyon group of an EU grant, a Marie Curie grant on data mining. She's also very much interested in two applications. She has connections to Amiens Lyon Business School already, as she's supervising a PhD student from Amiens Lyon on data mining, machine learning, and business applications. And also, to give you an idea of her interests, she has worked recently with LinkedIn on creating an online tutorial about machine learning for LinkedIn users and executives. So it's my great pleasure to welcome Céline Robardet to talk about cognition and machine learning.
Thank you. Oui. Thank you, Jean, for the introduction. So it's a pleasure for me to be here today to speak about the relationship between cognition and machine learning. And we will first start to define a little bit what is cognition. So cognition is a mental action or process of acquiring understanding and knowledge through suit experience and senses. So it's the ability that human beings have to process information by means of their senses, the perceptions, the stimuli that they receive by senses, and also to process knowledge acquired by experience. So with all this information, human beings are capable to understand and evaluate situations, and after that to take decisions. So as I have just said, the cognitive functions are very diverse. Some of the cognitive functions are related to the senses, so the vision, the auditions, and other senses. And other functions are related to the understanding, the reasoning, the memory. And as these cognitive functions are very diverse and complex, there is many cognitive sciences that are studying them. So, for example, anthropology, psychology, philosophy, and neurosciences are studying cognitive function. And they try to answer questions like, how is someone taking decision from only the perception of an environment? Or how, what are the mechanisms that underline the reasoning processes? And among these cognitive sciences, artificial intelligence goes a step further by trying to reproduce artificially these cognitive processes. So the idea is to use computer to realize what our brain is doing continuously in complex and changing environments. So artificial intelligence can consider a large amount of cognitive function. So ranging from very large, very general function like learning and perception, but also artificial intelligence can consider more specialized cognitive function like writing poetry, like diagnosing disease, or proving mathematical theorem. And among all these cognitive processes, ones have been studied for a long time, since the beginning of artificial intelligence. And this task require intelligence, memory, strategy building, and it is a chess playing game. So actually, it has been studied since the 50s, at the early beginning of artificial intelligence, because these games have always been considered as an intellectual game, and the pioneers in artificial intelligence were convinced that having a chess-playing machine would be the true sign of having an artificial intelligence. So two main strategies have been early identified for designing a chess-playing machine. A first strategy, a type A program, will mainly rely on brute force computation, so enumerating lots of combination of moves before taking a decision. And the other type of machine learning techniques the other type of chess playing machine will be a type B program that uses more strategic heuristics. So the idea is to define some rules that will reduce the number of moves to consider before taking an action. And at the beginning, in the 50s and the 60s, type B programs were favored because the computers were too limited to do brute force enumerations, so to consider many, many moves. And this changed in the 70s, when for the first time, a type A program won a championship, computer chess championship. And this was the beginnings of considering these more computer-intensive approaches. And this has many advantages. Using brute force computation is easier to implement. We do not have to understand really how humans are playing the game to reproduce it artificially. And second, the programs are less erratical. They behave in a way that is more similar than human beings than the type B program. So maybe the type A program that is the most known is the IBM Deep Blue. As it defeated in 1997 the world champion Garry Kasparov. It was a very mediatic event. So it was not a decisive defeat, but it was a decisive step of having a machine that have cognitive capabilities that are similar at a very high level as human beings. So even if this program, this IBM Deep Blue, was mainly rely on brute force enumeration, it was considering something like 200 million of moves per second. So it was really an intensive computation before taking a decision. It also uses some knowledge. some domain knowledge. For example, the evaluation function to decide if a move is a good move or not have been refined by researchers and by experts during decades. And it also uses some other rules to take some decision at some point of the game. And more recently, last year, in December 2017, a new milestone was reached in this chess-playing game with the AlphaZero algorithm, because this algorithm does not need any domain knowledge. It's only starting from a random play. It just uses the game of the rules, the game's rules, and after 24 hours of computation, it was able to have a sufficient level of play to compete with other machines. So, how does this AlphaZero algorithm works? I put on the slide the description of the author in their paper. They say, it plays mentally, so I like this, this term, it plays mentally different scenarios, giving priority to promising moves while also considering the unknown. When the computer reached an unexplored state, so a combination on the chessboard that was not considered before, it evaluates how favorable is the situation. So if this situation is a good situation for the player, for the computer or not. And it cascades back the score to the previous position in the enumeration tree, actually. So it does that a certain amount of time, depending on the time allowed by the computation. And once sufficient positions have been considered, it takes the one that it has considered the most and takes the moves. So it plays like that until the end of the game. And at the end of the game, it reevaluates all the potential mistakes he has done. So it's misjudged the situation. And it updates its knowledge, its understanding of the game accordingly. So explained like that, we have the impression to have a description of how human beings are learning how to play chess. And maybe just more, just with a more systematic way than at least I learned to play chess. So this it just use that, and the AlphaZero algorithm was a response to a great ambition actually of machine learning, because it learned how to realize a cognitive task just by teaching the first principles that are the game's rules and nothing else. So, as we have seen, artificial intelligence tries to reproduce artificially cognitive processes. And there exist several techniques to do that. And the one that gives today the best result is machine learning. Actually, underlying AlphaZero algorithm, there is several machine learning techniques that are used to realize the different tasks that I have described before. If you try to write a program that realizes a cognitive task, you will have to specify all the actions that we are doing while doing this this task, and these actions are not, we have no conscious of this action. For example, when I recognize a friend, what are the facial features that I use to do that? If I have no conscious of this, I am not able to write a program that will do that. So researchers in artificial intelligence tried over decades to do that, and they didn't success. Machine learning takes another way to do that. It starts from a large amount of data, and from the data, it generates automatically a program, a computer program, a machine, that is capable to classify or to realize the task as human beings. So it just used some examples, like here in the slide, some pictures of cats and dogs. And knowing that some pictures had, contain cats and others contain dogs, it learned a classifier that is a function that associates to the description of the picture the category of the picture, that is either the label cat or dog. So it's easy to implement. If the task changes a little bit, it can you can adapt your model easily. And you cannot, you don't have to understand really how human beings are doing this task to reproduce it artificially. So you can have machines that have better capabilities than is human program, sorry.
So, there exist three types of machine learning techniques. The supervised learning, the one that we have just seen, actually, when we know we have some example of the desired task. Another, the second type of machine learning techniques is reinforcement learning, where we have no example of the correct task, but we have a kind of function that say if the behavior is correct or not. Like in the chess playing game, we have some evaluation function that say if the situation is favorable or not for the game player. And the third main category is unsupervised learning, where we have no example and no additional information. We have only lots of data, and we want to find patterns in that data. For example, we have patients that are suffering from a disease, let's say autism, and we want to find some subgroup, some subtype of the disease. So I will now present a particular type of machine learning algorithm that is an artificial neural network. That is the technique that is useful. That made a great improvement these recent years and can realize with success many different tasks. So it is based on an analogy with our brain. So our brain is made of hundreds of billions of nerve cells called neurons. And these neurons have the particularity to be excitable cells that receive some stimuli from other neurons, transform it in a signal, in a bioelectrical signal, and this signal is propagated along the axon and at its turn stimulate other neurons. And when the number of stimulations that are received by a neuron are sufficiently high, the neuron can generate an impulse, that is at its turn, transmitted to other neurons and excitate other neurons. So in an artificial neural network, the propagation, we propagate not a signal, but the information among several neurons. So we have, in this picture, the neurons are the circles, and they are connected to other neurons, to which they can transmit their signal. So as input, we give our example. So here I stay with my example of cats and dogs that we want to classify. And this information propagates inside the neural network until a layer that is called the output layer of neuron, and that say if the picture is a dog or a cat. So each of the neurons are very limited capabilities of computation. They are doing very simple computation, but their combination with many other neurons make it possible to realize very complex functions. So each formal neuron only do what we call a weighted sum. Just the weighted sum between the X entries that are the data that arrive to the input connection of the neuron. So we have here three input connections. And to each connection, we have a weight that is a constant associated to the connection. And this weight is multiplied by the data, x, to make the weighted sum. And this weighted sum is transformed with an activation function. It's just a function that rescales the weighted sum into an interval between 0 and 1 to avoid having some neurons that have extreme value. Just a rescale to rescale the value between the interval 0 and 1. So it's rather simple. And the interconnection of this neuron met what we call a neural network. So generally, the neurons are organized in layers, and the neurons of one layer are connected to all the neurons of the next layer. We have two particular layers that are the input layers that receive the data, and the output layer that gives the classification decision. And if we have a network with at least two layers, two hidden layers, we say that it is a deep neural network, and that is what is generally used nowadays to do this task. So, as I said before, the weights associated to the connection are some constant. But these constants have to be learned to be adapted to the task we are considering. The weights will be different if I am classifying images, or if I am doing some speech recognition, or if I am doing some text translation. So these weights have to be learned, and the learning of this weight is done by comparing the desired output, so what we call is here the target, so it's a vector of values that we are expecting that to correspond to the input, and the realized output of the network, that is the output unit in green here. So we take the square difference between these two values. We take the average over all the examples, and this makes the error realized by the neural networks. And we have to minimize, we want to change the weights to minimize this error to have an as accurate as possible network to do the task. So this updating of the weight is done with what we call the gradient descent. Just we take the derivative of the function in a given point and use it to modify the weight in order to reduce the error. Once the weights have been learned, we can use the neural networks to classify new pictures, for example. And so this neural network are so powerful that they can now outperform human beings in realizing such certain tasks, like, for example, recognize object in image. Since 2015, we have machines that have better capabilities than human beings. So let us now consider other cognitive tasks. So this, we have seen some cognitive tasks that consist in creating predictive machines, so a particular task of cognitions. But we can also use artificial intelligence techniques to do other tasks, like data mining and data science are doing other tasks that differ a little bit from machine learning. So to explain it, I will contrast it with a machine learning objective. So as we have seen, machine learning try to design predictive machines that are as accurate as possible. And the main goal is automation. It's to replace men by machines, for example, with self-driving cars. Data mining objectives are a little bit different. It is to provide machines that can help humans while realizing very complex cognitive tasks. And it's especially useful for data science problems. When human beings are realizing tasks, such as increasing their knowledge for knowledge discovery. So the interpretability of the results and and the synergy with the user are important points in data mining. So I just made an allusion of data science, so I don't know if all of you knows what it is. It has been identified 10 years ago by Jim Gray as a new paradigm, a new scientific paradigm. So after the empirical science, the theoretical science, the simulation, that data-intensive science is a new paradigm that is required by science because the new instrument used by scientists like biologists or physicists, they generate lots of data and they cannot be analyzed by the scientists themselves. They need new techniques, new methods to extract knowledge from the large amount of data generated by these techniques. So this is the fourth paradigm. And data mining can be used in that context because when you have a large amount of data, it is futile to consider to want to consider a global model of all the data. It can be most value to consider only some observation in the data. For example, here in the picture, we have many data for which we cannot say, and it is difficult to say something because they are all spread all over the graphic. But I have put in color two phenomena that can be of interest because they are very particular. We have this square in top of the picture that are very narrow, and the circle in the bottoms. And that's the type of patterns that are looking for data mining techniques. From given a pattern language, it consists in searching for patterns of interest in the data. So we have to design to define a pattern language, the type of motif we are looking for. And using the constraint, we extract the patterns that are of interest for the end user in the data. The patterns that that may contain a new piece of information, and we use some algorithm to compute them. So there is to give user access to their data. There is four main challenges that have to be solved. First, we have to consider potentially complex data that mix very different type of data, numerical data, but also graphs. They can change over time, so dynamic data. We have also to integrate the complexity of the user because we are using some constraints. These constraints can be given by the user if he has conscious of what he's looking for. But this constraint can also be learned during the extraction process by interacting with the user. We have also to integrate the complexity of the domain because there is already some knowledge in the domain of interest that we can consider during the data mining process to avoid to return already known phenomena. And also, we have to take care of the complexity of the output to identify few patterns, few new potential phenomena, because these patterns have to be studied by the end user, and it takes time. So I just want to finish my presentation by giving you a few examples of what we have realized in my team to address these challenges. We have decided to use graphs as pattern language because it facilitates the communication with the end user. The graphs are easy to understand, and they also they are good tools between the user and his data. So, for example, here the nodes of the graph can be user in social media, but they can also be some movie, or they can be some airport, or also some velo stations. So they can model different type different type of data. And the relationship between the nodes can be the friendship in the social media. They can be the number of common actors between the movie, or the flights between airports, or the trips in the veil of data. And we can also have additional data associated to the nodes and also to the links. So I will give some example of the main task we have defined. So to find some pattern of interest in a graph with attributes associated to the nodes, we first derive some attributes, some topological attributes that describe the role of the nodes into the graph. For example, we can use the degree of the node to describe the importance of the node in the graph or its centrality measure. And we were looking for some correlation between these attributes, topological attributes, and also the attributes associated to the nodes. So maybe it will be clearer with an example. So on the IMDb database, maybe you know the IMDb Internet Movie Database. So you have all the movies, and users are rating the films, giving some rates between 0 stars to 5 stars, I think. And in this database, we have identified these three patterns, among others, but these three are the most interesting why. So the first one says the average rating is positively correlated with the number of ratings. They say that if the average score of a movie is high, potentially this movie has many scores, many ratings. And the physical, the social phenomena outside that is that people tend to rate movies they like. So this is the English translation of this strange patterns. The second pattern says that the number of ratings is positively correlated with the degree. In English, it says that people tend to rate movies with major actors, because the links between two movies are the fact that they share actors. So a movie with a high degree is a movie with a high connection with other movies, so that has actors that play in many other movies. And this is what we call major actors. And the last pattern says that the standard deviation in the ratings is negatively correlated with the page rank. So the page rank is a centrality measure. And that says that if the standard deviation is high, it means that there is some controversial evaluation of the movie. Some people like the movie and others dislike. And this is controversial movie. And these movies are not central in the graph because they are negatively correlated with the patch rank. So they are, we say that they are isolated. So this is the first type of pattern mining tasks that we have defined. I want to also present you another task that we have defined to analyze a dynamic attributed graph. So that is a graph where the structure of the graph change over time, but also the attributes associated to the nodes. And we wanted to extract some subgraphs, some part of the graph associated to a time interval for which the attributes evolve similarly. So either there are increases over all the time interval or there are decreases. Here also, I think that an example will help to understand what I'm saying. So we apply this technique on the US flight database. So it's a database about all the flights in the United States. And I have represented here two patterns. One in red gathers 71 airports whose arrival delays increases over the 3 weeks after the Katrina hurricanes. So this is the airport that have been impacted by the hurricane. actually. And as we can see, these airports are all over the United States because there is connection between the Florida and all the other parts. So mainly all the airports in the United States have been impacted by the hurricane. And there is also 5 airports in yellow. They are located mostly near the hurricane track. And these airports have a number of flights. Their number of flights increases during the 3 weeks after the hurricanes. And if we look carefully to this airport, we can see that substitution flights were provided from this airport during the hurricane because the Florida was completely impacted by the hurricane and it was not possible to send flights from the source of America. So it was using these techniques, it's just an example of what we can automatically find in the data without any previous knowledge. So these techniques are nice, but the main drawback is that they generate a lot of patterns. And sometimes it's quite difficult to find the 2 or 3 patterns that I have shown to you because they are completely lost in a very large amount of patterns. So more recently, we have considering of extracting some exceptional patterns. That is patterns that are really different of what we can observe on the whole graph. And the task we consider here was to analyze the VELOV data. We wanted to analyze the graph of the data of the VELOV data, where we have the VELOV station as nodes. We have the trips between the stations that are the links of the graph. And we have also some additional information associated to the links that are the gender of the user, for example, that makes the trips, the day of the week, or other additional information. And from this graph, so with labels or information on the edges, we wanted to discover some subgraph associated to a context such that the subgraph is exceptional given the context. So here also, I think that an example will help to understand. Here is one of the subgraphs we have obtained. It's a subgraph that connects that make connection between the universities of Lyon and the context in top of the graphic associated to this graph. Is that these trips are mainly realized by young men. So the trips between university are mainly realized by young men. We have also extended this work by making possible to include some domain knowledge. For example, the trips between the distances influence the probability of having a trip. So trips between nearby stations are more expected, or trips between highly populated area are also more expected. And so we can include this domain knowledge into our data mining algorithm to find more surprising patterns. And it is also possible to include to take into consideration the feedback of the user. In this work, we propose a method to detect event geolocated events from Twitter data, and we generate some events, and we presented it to the user, and the user has the possibility to say that he's interested or not by the event. And we take into consideration the events that it is interested in, and favor the hashtags and the location that are included in this event to provide a new event to extract new events that are of most interest for the user. So by interacting with the algorithm, the user modifies the constraints. And the algorithm provides to the user patterns that are potentially more interesting for him. And our most recent work, it is still ongoing work, In this work, rather than using some constraints to define the pattern of interest, we model the user beliefs or probabilities, and we extract the patterns that are the most informative for the user, but also patterns that are easy to assimilate. We take into account the complexity of the patterns before presenting it to the user. So it's time for me to conclude. Today I wanted to present you some example of artificial intelligence algorithm to let you know what they are exactly. And also I presented to you some example of machine learning algorithm and applications. So now artificial neural network give very good results, for example, to recognize objects in images, but also to translate text and also to speak recognition. So I think that in your daily life now, you are using some applications, some commercial applications that realize this task, and they are doing it using neural network. And I also wanted to share with you some of the work we are doing in Lyon in data mining processes to find some knowledge from data, because maybe in the room there is some researchers that have data, and maybe they are looking for tools, and we can maybe collaborate. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Céline, for this great talk. The floor is open for questions now.
Hello. So I found the presentation really interesting. So the subject is interesting, but what I was curious about, and maybe it comes in a later conference, is how much and what do we need to know as people that are going into the workplace to benefit from artificial intelligence. It means it could be a benefit to know things, but what do we need to know to benefit from it, I guess?
It depends what you are doing in your life, actually. So I think there is many advances, and the field is very moving fast these days. And new tasks are realized more and more efficiently. So it's important to stay up to date to know what the machines are now capable to do for images, for speech recognition, for translation. So there are many fields that have gained a lot of efficiency using these techniques. And the question is, what are the next steps? It's difficult to say that now, but depending on your field of interest, you can use these techniques if you have some idea of the machine learning techniques, if you have some idea of what you are looking for, the tasks that you want to automate. And it's sometimes it's difficult to know what to automate. So what is the variable you want to predict? Depending on the field, it's not easy to know. So I don't know if I answer the question, but.
If you want to recognize patterns, and I mean, I don't know, you're a marketing director, what do you need to learn to be able to, maybe not use, but at least understand how the algorithm, how the AI works?
To recognize a pattern in pictures, you mean?
Yeah, for instance.
You have to learn that there is some special neurons that are convolutional neurons that are some features on the picture that you will learn actually. So to recognize a car, for example, you will have some automatically the neural network will learn some features that are graphical features, because pictures are in two dimensional. So maybe you can have a look on that, on convolutional neural networks.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. I'm asking a question about probably a common interest in between you and me, particularly associated with a shared bike. Currently, I have a project in Beijing. So I have data about 8 million shared bike. I collect this big data, and I use this big data to study consumer behavior. Based on this feature of consumer behavior, I try to do an operation decision, namely a facility location decision. That's, for example, if I want to open a new supermarket, based on this big data of shared bike, I probably can combine big data analyze with optimization, particularly energy optimization, to help me to make a decision. I live in Lyon, so I'm particularly interested in sharing bike in Lyon, like the project you just presented. I'm also trying to, actually I had to think about probably I can also use the big data for sharing bike in Lyon to do my research. So I want to ask some question, because when I consider sharing bike project in Beijing, actually the sharing bike is linked with a mobile phone. That means I know the location, I know the time, I know the person associated with the shared bike. This can help me to study consumer behavior. So in Lyon, the shared bike is associated with some card, right? It's not associated with a mobile bike, mobile phone. So my question is, I don't know whether I can use this kind of big data information to understand consumer behavior in Lyon. I don't know whether you have some clues.
Yeah, I mean, to understand the behavior of peoples, it's better to cross many information, so you can cross effectively the data, transportation data with velops, or also public transport. But also you can use some social media to with a tweet, or also with other social platform to have other information. And by crossing all this information, you can gain some insight about your customer and to understand what are the main behavior to target your business at the end towards this population. So it's by mixing different data, I think.
Yeah, another thing associated with data collection. For example, I can say the sharing bike, I cooperate with some big sharing bike companies. So in Lyon, if I want to get this kind of data, how can I get access to?
You have some data that are available from the city house, the Lyon. There is a Lyon open data, I think.
And this is open, or this probably is not open, right?
The availability of the bikes, and there is some data, I think. The number of bikes in stations, the number of so if you are considering the data, you can infer the traffic in each station. So you can have some information from this data, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome.
Other questions? Okay, well, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.
Okay, we are lacking a slide that was just to announce the talk to come, the coming talk in the series. It's going to be in 3 weeks from now on February the 12th by another researcher from the Lyon area, Professor Velsin, who is going to talk about machines and language, and this time the talk will be in French. So for those French speakers or others who pick up French, you are welcome to join us in 3 weeks for the talk on machines and language. Thank you very much.